Hey there, welcome back. I am, as you can see right down there, Christopher Harrison. That is
Chris Johnson.
And we're just about to start with Module 2 here, list sites and all that good stuff. For those of you who were watching just a couple of minutes ago, you'll notice that we did have one small little challenge with our prior demo. So what I want to do is I want to go back, fix that, or actually, not even fix it. Just simply show that, hey, it did in fact work. And then we'll pick it up with Module 2 from there. So if you want to go back to my demo system here, honestly, here's all that I did. We went to break, yep. I hit refresh, and it worked. So thank you for calling the help desk. Have you tried turning it off, turning it back on again? And it worked. So
who knows? Yeah. It's one of those little gremlins that happens. I think maybe clicking around too quick or something like that. Who knows?
I think that might have been it. I think I might have just been, yay, I'm doing a demo, and just hit activate twice.
Yeah, it's the same. Yeah. It's the same solution. It's the same system. We didn't do anything sort of sneaky, up our sleeves or anything like that.
This is it. Like, literally all I did was I just simply hit refresh. In any event, so picking up where we left off here. So here's our little site. And so there it is. And now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to hit home here, just to go back to our little home environment. And right up at the top, I'm going to hit page and edit. And let me hit insert, and then let me zoom in here real quick, because you're going to notice that we've got two little buttons there for our parts. That you're going to notice that we've got web parts and we've got app parts. So if you are developing an app part, you'll notice you'll be able to choose that from there. In our case, we've got a web part. It's a visual web part, but it's a web part nonetheless. So I'm just going to choose a web part there. And I'm going to go grab my demo web parts. And then you'll notice that there is my Hello World web part.
So it's off in that group, that the demo web parts group that you added it to. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
You tweaked the group there so it shows up in a meaningful spot as opposed to just custom.
Exactly.
And yep. There's your web part. Nice.
Yep. There it is. So just like Chris mentioned, yeah, we updated the UI. So you'll notice that we get our demo web parts, we get our hello web part, and then you'll also notice right over there a demo that will display your name. So I'm going to click add here. Loading. Moving your mouse makes it go faster. There we go. And let me go ahead and hit save. Now, you'll notice that it threw in untitled, and I could go in and play around with that, but we're starting to get a little ahead of ourselves on that.
Tweak the look and feel and all of those sorts of things through those web part properties.
Yeah. Exactly. Yep. But in any event, what I'm going to do is just simply punch out a name, and I'm going to use Chris's name rather than mine. So I'll just go ahead and say Chris, and then hit submit, and voila, there is our little Hello World
Chris.
Web part. Hello,
nice.
Chris.
So although it looks ultra basic from the visual angle of this, mm-hmm. I think, just going back to what we were saying about this was a visual web part deployed in a sandbox solution into a SharePoint farm.
Let's say that one more time.
So this was a visual web part deployed into a sandbox solution onto our farm.
And that's a big change, again, from 2010. That in 2010, if you wanted to do visual web parts, the only way to do it was to set that up as a farm solution or go get the add-in. Now you'll notice out of the box, just boom, away we go. That's cool. All right. And it worked. Yay. All right. Let me go back to the slides here. There we go. Wait for the system. This is the physical version of moving your mouse. Makes it go
Oh, I
faster.
See. Yeah, it's like it's got Kinect or something.
Exactly. Exactly. Yes. Yes. All right. In any event, let's roll on into Module 2, lists and sites. If you hear me talk about SharePoint for more than about a minute and a half, the one thing that you're going to hear me say over and over and over and over again is everything is a list. And the reason that I like to keep harping on that is because there's frequently just so much confusion about, you know, document libraries and different types of data and all that that I'm going to have inside of inside of SharePoint. So I really just like to hone in on the fact that everything is a list, because at the end of it all, everything is in fact a list. Everything inside of a list is a list item. So once you understand how to work with one list, making the move then into anything else becomes a lot easier, becomes a lot more straightforward. So everything is a list.
Yeah, you have document libraries, mm-hmm. Are called document libraries in SharePoint, yep. But they're also lists, right?
Exactly.
So they're just special document special lists, I should say.
That's exactly it. And so our lists are going to store our data. And so when it comes time to actually put something, when it comes time to model data inside of SharePoint, we are going to need some form of a list that's going to hold all of that. Our lists are going to have our columns. That's going to establish our metadata, which is really just a very fancy way of saying data about data. This is what we're going to use to describe the information that we're going to be storing. And since we know we're going to be asking for certain types of data, we want to make sure that there's going to be some consistency there. So you're going to notice that we've got the ability to create a list template, which is going to give us the ability to create a type of list. So like Chris mentioned earlier, document library, type of list, we're going to go in, create a type of list. So we'll be able to go in and do that. We'll also be able to create our own custom site templates or web definitions as well, which we're going to take a look at. But let's start off by talking a little bit about the component hierarchy, and let's talk about the main objects that we're going to have inside of SharePoint.
Sure. Actually, while we're on this topic, somebody in the chat room has said, let's mention in 2013 that everything is an app, including a list. So I think what they're referring to there
right.
is in the UI of SharePoint 2013, when you go into the site contents of when you click on the site contents link down on the
yep.
left-hand side there, and you go through to the area that shows you what you've got in your site,
yep.
It says, you know, apps and add an app. And
yep.
so in 2013, it was sort of renamed from, you know, add a list to add an app. And so adding an app either a custom app or a document library, things are considered apps in there now.
Yeah.
And the different types of apps might have different things in them, and one of those things is lists.
Yeah, that's actually a very good point. That's a very good point. So bring that back into our little hierarchy here. We've got our component hierarchy, we've got our columns, our content types, and our list columns and content types. So let's start off by taking a look at our component hierarchy. Now, I've trimmed this down just a little bit, that there's other moving parts as well, that we do have a farm, we do have services and so forth, but I really kind of honed in on the items that we're going to be working with on a most common basis. So up at the root of everything is our web application, and that's going to be the main container for an on-premises solution for all of our site collections. The big things that our web applications are going to be able to do for us is determine what services it is that we want. So maybe we need two different search implementations, so we'd have two different web applications for that. And it's also going to determine the authentication mechanisms that are available. So if I need forms authentication in one spot, and I need Windows and forms in a different spot, then that's going to be two separate web applications.
Yeah, you know, this is kind of, web applications are analogous in the IIS model to, you know, creating a new site,
yep.
a new web app in IIS. The same as in SharePoint, they map one-to-one.
Yep, exactly. Down below that is our site collection. A web application will contain one or more site collections. And sort of like the name implies, a site collection is, wait for it, it is a collection or a container for sites. Now, there's a couple of different things that we're able to do at the site collection level that we're not able to do anywhere else. In particular, we're only able to establish quotas at the site collection level, not down to the site level, not down to the list level. There's also a lot of different search things that can only be done at the site collection level. And then also, if we get a little bit more onto the admin side of things, at the site collection level, we can specify a different content database. So if we've got very large site collections, we've got a large amount of data, and I want to be able to offload that to different databases for performance, I can do that at the site collection level.
Yeah, so like you said about authentication is based at the web application level. Site collections map under the hood, they map down to a database that
yep.
all of that content is going to sit in. And so, you know, for developers, when you're thinking about building a solution, It's nice to have a good high-level view of how things are going to map out and be stored.
Yep.
Because you don't want to create one site collection necessarily that contains, you know, terabytes of data necessarily. You want to be able to keep an eye on how that's going to map down into a database and the management and so forth of that.
Yep. Down below our site collection, or contained inside of our site collection, is one or more sites. And sites provide the structure for our environment. So our sites are going to be containers for other sites. They're going to be containers for lists. And really the main goal of a site is that's how I'm going to group like parts of data together. So if I've got something maybe around a meeting, sort of a classic example, if I've got something maybe for a particular team and they all need access to this block of data, this block of data, this block of data, generally speaking, the best way to accomplish that is put all of that together inside of a site.
Yeah, think of it as a unit of content, right?
Sure.
It's a hierarchy-based unit of content. You know, inside there you've got sites underneath it. From a developer's perspective, it gets a little confusing. If you look at the server object model, you'll notice there's SP site and SP web.
Yep.
So SP site maps to site collection, the unit of a site collection, whereas SP web maps to webs that are within that site collection. And so that's that hierarchy of sites that I mentioned. So from the nomenclature and the API is slightly different than some of the words you'll see in the main SharePoint UI. But when we say site, typically we're talking about a site collection.
Right. Yeah, and actually if we kick back over, I've updated the site here, or the slide here, and I did put SP in front of there. Sorry, you know, just old habits die hard. SP is the server side
object
model,
yep.
There. You'll notice site and web. Then when we get into the client side object model, the SP goes away. So it's just simply site or web. On the server side object model, it's SP site, SP web. But regardless, it's still the exact same. That site is a site collection, and web is a site. And if I can go one step further with that, if I can offer just a little bit of advice, that whenever you're naming your variables, use the names of the environment that you're in. So even though the UI might say site collection, when you declare the variable, call it a site. And even though the UI might say site, when you declare the variable, call it a web, just because it's going to make your life easier. I'm just a big believer. Organization consistency will set you free.
Right, right. So one of the comments that we had in the chat was mentioning some of the business use along the way for these various components.
Mm-hmm.
And so the advice I would give around site collections, because they're a discrete unit of content or and that you can distribute amongst various databases.
Mm-hmm.
Permissions are granted at a site collection level. You can break inheritance of the permissions further down, but think of them as one unit of measure. So a good example of how this would map to a SharePoint environment might be a particular project might have a site collection.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason you might want to do that is because when the project goes away and finishes, you might want to be able to archive that whole site collection all at once. And take it away. Whereas if you build your site hierarchy with subwebs along the way,
mm-hmm.
it makes it much easier, much harder, I should say, to deal with those subwebs later on. So rather than necessarily bucketing thousands of project webs all within one site collection, you might want to think about splitting those out at a higher level. That's a tough question to ask without knowing your organization, but it's something to consider.
Exactly. Yeah, that to try and answer questions like that, there's a lot more involved, really having to kind of go back and forth, figure out exactly what it is that you're trying to accomplish, what data you're trying to store, who needs access to it. There's a lot of questions that need to be asked along with that. Now, the analogy that I always love whenever it comes to SharePoint is databases. That our site collection, you think about a SQL instance, and that's our container for databases. Our sites are databases. That's eventually going to contain our tables, which will contain our rows. In SharePoint terms, our site is going to contain, well, other sites, but it's going to contain lists. And lists are where our data is going to be stored. Again, everything is a list. That's where all of our data is going to be. On every single list, we're going to have columns. And inside of our list, we're going to have items, which would be analogous to our rows. So columns to columns and items to our rows. So if you're a database person, say SQL or MySQL or that database that comes from that company that starts with an O.
Yeah, I'm not sure what you're talking about.
Yeah, something like that. But in any event, if you're familiar at all with any one of those environments or even Access, and you've done a database, you have a pretty good understanding already of how SharePoint is sort of structured there. So we've got our list, we've got our columns, and we've got our items.
And you know, just to confuse matters, if anybody goes poking around in SharePoint's internals and takes a look in the content database, those lists don't necessarily don't map one-to-one to tables inside of SQL.
No.
So all of your list data ends up in a table inside of SQL. It didn't used to be like that way back in SharePoint days, but now you can think of a list as a table, the analogy you used, but if you go looking around in the database, which you know, some people have a tendency to go take a look at, you're not going to find one table per list.
Right, exactly. And really the general guidance when it comes to the database is treat it like a black box, that just leave it alone and let SharePoint do everything that it needs to do.
Yeah, you certainly don't want to go and fiddle around with things in there.
No. Unless you like support calls.
Yeah. Well, and if you go change stuff in the database and things, you'll end up breaking your support with Microsoft. So it's definitely not a great idea.
Exactly. Now, bring it back to the slide here real quick. I just want to highlight under our site or SP web, we've got our columns, our content types. And then again, under our list library, we've got our columns or fields, which is how they're known as inside the APIs. And then you'll notice our content types. Now, all of that is just simply a lead-in to the next little section here. That when we're talking about storing data inside of SharePoint, again, it's all about organization and consistency, that quite frequently we're going to have the exact same data, but I need to store that in different places. That maybe, for example, we've got different sales leads, and I want to be able to store our sales leads over here for Northwest, and over here for Southwest, and over here for, you know, inside of different lists. And even though I might be creating different lists for our different regions, at the end of the day, a sales lead is a sales lead is a sales lead. And they're still going to be first name and last name and email address and phone number and proposal or whatever else it is that you might have, regardless of the list that it's in. And again, organization and consistency. I want to make sure that if it's a sales lead, it's always going to look like a sales lead, regardless of where it is. The way that we describe our data inside of SharePoint is by using columns. And I can go directly to a list and I can add on a column, but I'd really prefer to not do that, because if we just go to a list and we add on a column, I've modified that instance of that list and I'm not going to get reuse. So fortunately, what we can do in SharePoint is we can create columns at the site level. Now, keep in mind that when you create a column at the site level, it will flow down all child types. So you will get inheritance there. Now, the thing about a site column is that it's the definition, it's not the actual implementation. That this is where I'm going to describe, hey, this is the data that I'm going to store, but it's not actually going to store the data. Lists store data. This is going to be used by a list to describe the data that's going to be stored inside of there. So this is describing the data, but this is not actually storing the data. Again, all that's going to be inside of our list.
Yeah, it's great for usability, right? So
yep.
You define a column once at a site collection level as a site column.
Yep.
And then you can use it in multiple lists in different sites.
Exactly. And then you're going to notice on the creation side that we can do this declaratively, which we're going to take a look at in a few minutes. We can do this through the object model, or we could just do this through the SharePoint UI. Now, doing it through the SharePoint UI is by far the easiest way to do it. That you just simply go into the site settings page, you go in and click on the little site columns link, you go ahead and click on add, you define everything inside of there, and away you go. The challenge, however, with doing that inside of there is that's limited to now just that site and then all the child sites, that I'm not going to get any portability. So if I need that inside of this site collection, this side of this site collection, inside of this site collection, or inside of this web app, this web app, this web app, or heck, even this farm, and this farm, or this O365 tenant and this O365 tenant, I'm not going to get that if I just simply go in through the UI. This is where doing this declaratively comes into play, that let's ball this up, put this into a solution, and now we get reuse, now we get portability, now I can take that and use that in a lot of different locations.
Yeah, and also, you know, obviously from a developer's perspective, managing the code and the application lifecycle of that code is really important as well. So if you just define a site column through the UI of the browser, then you're not managing the definition of that column in a file that sits off in a source code repository, for example.
Yep.
So from a dev perspective, it's often nice to get those definitions out into your solution in Visual Studio using the same source control system that you'd use for other projects and so forth, and have that all nicely managed and version controlled.
Yep, exactly. All right. Now, having an individual column is okay. You know, that what I could then do is I could go to all my different lists and I keep adding that column in. But think about your data. Your data is never just one column. Your data is multiple columns. So rather than going to this list and adding on this column, and this column, and then going over to another list and adding on the exact same column, 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 and then that's going to get a little bit old.
Wouldn't it be great if you had a concept that let you group columns together? Dun, dun, dun.
I like where you're going with this. So wouldn't you know that we have this cool little thing called a site content type. Now, at its most basic, a site content type is a collection of columns. Now, what I do is I go in, I create my content type, and I say, all right, well, I want it to have this column, and this column. And then what I do is I go to my list, and I point it at the content type. And once I point it at the content type, it will automatically get all the columns that are inside of that content type. And there's a lot of great advantages to this. That first of all, now all of that's going to be centralized. Second of all, it's going to be one unit of work. But last and certainly not least, when we're just talking about columns on a content type, is I get centralized management. The only thing that is, of course, truly consistent in development is change. And at some point, we're going to need a brand new column. Now, if I've modified 8 different lists, and I realize, oh, wait a minute, I need a brand new column, I'm going to have to run around to all those lists and add that column in. Or if I think about maybe creating a list template, which we are going to get into, the problem with the list template is that once you create the template off, or once you create the list based off of that template, there's a separation, that it's essentially a cookie cutter. So when I go in and I lay out my cookie dough, and I go in and I use the little cookie cutter, and I go off and I bake my cookies, if I break that cookie cutter, it's not going to have any impact on the cookies. Sort of the same concept here with our list template, that if I go in and I modify our list template, it's not going to impact any of the lists that I've created off of that template. But if the list points at a content type, and now I add a column to that content type, all the lists will now see that change. Because they were pointing at the content type, they didn't actually have the columns defined locally on the list itself.
Right, so it's a great way to, you know, you've got reusable columns, you group them into content types. So a good example of this would be, say, a specification document, right? You might store specification documents for your various projects in all sorts of different libraries, right?
Yep.
And you define one specification content type and put the columns on that and then add that content type to a number of different libraries. And then when you want to add a new column to your specification, maybe you know, RTM date for the feature that you're building,
yep,
or complete date or something like that, you can add it to the content type, you can then push it down and it's available to all of those libraries that use that content type. It's also worth noting, I think, that content types can inherit from other content types. So a good use of this is the ability to create a set of organizational content types. So maybe a base document content type or a base specification content type that has maybe 2 or 3 fields. And then other folks can come along and create a new content type that inherits from one of those. So say you had a base specification content type, you could say, I don't know, custom software specification could be a new content type that inherits from spec and then adds additional columns to it. And so you can build up this hierarchy of content types that inherit from one another and so forth.
Exactly. Now, to go beyond just simply columns, content types can have a lot of other things associated with them, that they could actually have a document template. So if maybe as part of that specification there's a Word document that needs to be filled out, we can associate that with the content type. So that way I go in and I say, all right, well, I want a new specification, and then poof, it will launch Word with that document template that I then want to use. On top of that, if there's any global event receivers or any global workflows, that I can go ahead and put that onto the content type. So kind of keeping along with that same specification example, that there's a very good chance that there's some form of a workflow that needs to be followed with that specification, that there's a particular manager that needs to sign off on it, and then, you know, IT needs to sign off on it, and a project manager needs to sign off on it, whatever it is. And again, regardless of where we happen to be using that specification, it's probably always going to be the same, or at the very least a similar workflow. And so we can go in and define that workflow, associate that with the content type, so that way, regardless of the list that we're using it on, we'll always be able to have that workflow available.
Yeah, so there's, you've mentioned a few things that you can tag onto content types. You can also do things like information policies.
Yes.
About the use of those content types, and the things like retention periods can be applied at a content type level rather than just at a library level.
Yep.
Also, somebody brought up about managing content types. So one of the questions I get asked a lot is around, you know, where do I define the content types? How do I manage them across huge organizations and so forth? And so it'd probably be, you know, worthwhile bringing up the concept of this, what we call a content type hub, which is like a central distribution point for content types to various sites. So again, if you've got multiple site collections, because content types can be defined at the site collection level, and you want to push your organization's standard content types out into those site collections, you could use a content type hub as a central distribution point for all those standard organization-wide content types.
Now, one little thing to note about that, and it's actually one of my favorite little features that came along with 2010, is that that does require the managed metadata service, MMS, to be set up, and that's only available on SharePoint server, be it standard or enterprise. It's not available on SharePoint Foundation, unfortunately.
Right.
Yeah. So, now, as far as setting up our content types, again, just like with a site column, we can do this declaratively, we can do this as part of the object model, we can do this through the UI. Now, just to hopefully kind of put a nice little bow on that entire conversation, you'll notice that we've got a little slide here where we mention what we're defining at the site level and what we're doing at the list level. So at the site level, we can create a column, we can create a content type. And again, our content type will have columns. So we can, at the list, point to a site column. But keep in mind that if we do that, we're modifying the list. So if we've got, you know, five different lists that we all need the exact same, I don't want to run around and keep adding in the site column to each one of those. Let's do it one time, put it into the content type, and then when I go into my list and I say, here, use this content type, it will then pull down all of those columns.
That's right, yeah.
Okay, so without any further delay, let's go in and take a look at setting up our site columns and our content types. Okay. I'm amazed I actually made it that long before I accidentally turned off my monitor. Cool.
You have to tell us.
Yeah. All of a sudden everything went black. Ah, panic. Okay. So in any event, for those of you that are watching, you'll notice we've got these little monitors right here, and they really are nice, you know, touchscreen, the whole nine yards. But right over here, there's the power button, and this thing is just uber sensitive. That if you just breathe on it, funny, it turns off. So, all right. In any event. Let me go ahead and just kind of keep things separate. I'm going to create a brand new project here, and this will be our content types. Actually, I'm going to call this data structure. That's what I'm going to call it. I'm just going to change my mind there, and let me hit OK. And once again, let's do this as a sandbox solution, and I'm going to hit finish. OK, Cool. So now let me go ahead, right-click, and add new item here. Now, you know, you'll notice that we've got all of our little templates here. And Chris, I have a bit of a confession to make here.
Uh-oh.
Okay.
Live on air.
Yes, here it is. Are you ready? In all my years of doing development, I think I could probably count on one hand the number of times that I actually sat down, fired up the camel, and put together my own column, my own content type, my own list template. It was just such a pain.
Right. So when you're talking about camels, we got to be a little bit careful
okay,
here, right?
You're right. You're right.
For those who don't understand what we're talking about when we say camel, it's an abbreviation or an acronym, CAML.
Right.
Not the humped variety that you jump on in the desert and ride out in places.
Yes.
So we're talking about camel language, which right. is a XML-based definition language that
right.
we use in SharePoint for doing some of these things.
Exactly, yeah. Collaborative Application Markup Language, CAML. And one of the things that Visual Studio didn't offer in the past was a very nice editor for a lot of the camel. We had some of it, you know, like the features, the solution, all of that was fantastic in 2010. 2007, we basically had nothing.
Yeah, there were some third-party things
there,
that
there
people
was.
Created.
There was a lot of great third-party support, absolutely. But yeah, not in Visual Studio. Now, I'm just going to go into Site Column, and let's go ahead and just create a very basic little setup here. And you like doing movies, you said?
Yeah, absolutely. I love movies.
Okay. All right. So then let's go ahead and let's do a movie. And let's go ahead and create a real quick column here of movie description. It's my first day with a keyboard. There we go. So movie description. And let me hit add. And so what you're going to notice is that we do get our XML pre-built. Now, you are going to notice that we don't necessarily get a fantastic editor here. But the couple of really nice parts that have automatically taken place here for us is it has set up most everything that we would normally want. That you'll notice that it did create the ID automatically for us, so we don't have to go and set up the GUID. It does set up the internal name without spaces. It does set up our display name, so it picked up my Pascal casing, put that into there. And then you'll also notice that we do get our type. And so inside of here, I can then go in and specify whatever I want my type to be it a choice column or otherwise. And then I also get to specify my little group, and let's say movies. There we go. All right, so at least we got the XML. All right.
That's great if you know what all the attributes are. You get a base template there
yeah.
that you can see, and then you can fiddle with the different, the names and the group and that sort of thing.
Yep. So. But let's take a look at the really cool one here. I'm going to right-click, and I'm going to say Add, and I'm going to say New Item. And let's go ahead and grab our content type, and this is going to be our movie. Movie. There we go. And let's go ahead and hit Add. And, oh, will you look at this?
That's a wizard.
That is a wizard. One of the things that Chris mentioned earlier is the ability to do inheritance. So we might have kind of our base specification, and then we might have different types for, say, SharePoint or for MVC or for whatever else it is that you might be building. And we're going to go in and create our one base and then go in and inherit. And so whenever we create a content type, we can go in and do our inheritance. Now, first of all, if you're doing this through the UI, it's very straightforward. You go in, you say, I want a new content type. You choose the content type, and away you go. If you're doing this through the camel, which is what we're doing right here, this gets a little bit trickier.
Mm.
Because what you need is you need the content type ID. That the way that a content type ID is built is it's based off of everything that it inherits from. So you've got the initial code, so say 01 in the case of an item, and then a couple of zeros, and then the GUID for whatever custom one it is that you created, and then two zeros, and then the GUID for the next one, and then two zeros, and then the GUID for the next one. And after a while, I mean, having to track all that down and put all that together, it winds up being about, there we go, we'll actually stay in frame there, it winds up being about that long. And that really just becomes tedious. And so fortunately, one of the big things that this little wizard will do for us, it will not only set up the inheritance, but it will set up the ID automatically for us. So that way we don't actually have to go into our site settings, pull up the prior content type, look up inside the URL, and go find the ID inside of there. This just does it for us.
Yeah, it does a lot of that heavy lifting, right? That you'd have to go digging around and finding those IDs and then trying to handcraft it and then hoping that you'd got it right and all of those sorts of things.
Exactly. So let me go ahead and just leave that with item. We'll kind of keep it relatively straightforward. And then let's hit finish.
So item is, that's kind of like the base level content type, right? It's effectively just the definition for a row in a list, right?
Yep.
It's not, hasn't been enhanced in any way. It doesn't have a whole bunch of columns already on it. And those sorts of things. So it's a nice one that if you just want a blank content type, it's a great place to start from.
Exactly. All right. So, you know, I got to tell you, when I was your age, we didn't have cool little UIs like this.
You had gravel for breakfast, and you didn't have shoes, and you didn't have a nice wizard either, huh?
Exactly.
Nice.
So what you're going to notice right here is that I get an awesome UI that I can now use to choose all of the columns that I want inside of my content type. Isn't that just fantastic?
So much easier.
Yes, exactly. So I get to go in and choose whatever item it is that that I might want. Where's my description? Where was I? I'm just kind of, you know, just paging down aimlessly there. Come here. Let's just...
There movie description.
Movie description.
There we go.
Perfect. There we go. Let's go ahead and choose that. And then you'll notice, hey, we could go ahead and grab the next one that we might want and kind of keep on going on from there. So we'll just go ahead and keep things nice and simple.
So this is adding columns, either site columns or to your content type, correct?
Exactly. Now, if I see my columns, there's all my columns that I can now use. And then if I come over here to the content type, now is where I get to specify how that content type is going to appear. So I can give this a name of movie. I can give this a name of describes movies, like that. I can choose the particular group that I want that to be in. Let's actually just call this our movie content types. Like that. And you'll notice that I can also choose whether or not it's going to inherit the columns from the parent content type, whether or not it's going to be read-only, whether or not we're going to hide it from the new button, so that you could only do that with say, PowerShell. All right. In any event, let me go ahead and deploy this. I'm just going to do a real quick right-click and deploy and push this out to my little site. Now, one of the things that I want to mention there is while this is doing its thing and it's doing a deploy, you're going to notice that last time we did a publish. And all that publish does is it just simply uploads the WISP file, the solution, and that's it. That it doesn't activate it or doesn't bring it to life. It just simply deploys it out. When you do a deploy from Visual Studio, it will take the next step and actually activate it. And what's nice about that is that if you're trying to just do some testing, which is exactly what I've done here. By the way, I just realized I have a typo there. Describe moves instead of movies. That's all right, though. In any event, when you go in and you do your deploy, it will automatically activate it, which makes it much easier to test. It just saves that additional step. Or going back to an earlier demo, it just saves from accidentally trying to activate
clicking
it
twice. Clicking the buttons, yeah.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. All right. So in any event, let me go into my site settings. I like how each version, they move site actions from one side to the other.
It's so a trend. It's either on the left or the right, and then back again just to keep things real. Right?
Exactly. Yes, we're just keeping everybody on their toes. So what you're going to notice, sure enough, if I go into my content types, and let's just do a real quick, my control F doesn't want to work. Okay, fine. We called it movies. There we go. There's our little movie description that we created earlier. And if I kick on back to our content types, and let's go ahead and scroll down. And then sure enough, there is our little movie content types. And if I open that up, we can now see our little movie content type. So it's got the title, which it inherited from item, and it's got the movie description, which we now added in.
Yeah, so sometimes these lists get quite long, right? Mm-hmm. So over on the right-hand side, under the source column, you can see where the columns have come from. And so in this case, the title came from the base item content type. But as these things grow, it's really nice to be able to refer to this and see where they've all come from.
Exactly, exactly. So let's just close this off real quickly here. I'm just going to go back to the gear, add in an app. Again, that's where our lists are,
right?
Inside of apps. Let's go ahead and choose custom list. And let's go ahead and say movies. And hit create. And let's open up our movies here. There we go. And I'm going to go into my list and list settings. And then if I go into my list settings, you're going to notice nowhere inside of here does it mention content types.
Right. By default, it hasn't got content types turned on, right?
Exactly. We just need to go into advanced settings. Put the little dot next to yes, allow management of content types. And then let's scroll on down, hit OK. And now there are our content types.
Right, right. So now you can go in and add, say, that movies one to this list, right?
Yep. So we'll just hit add. Movies. There we go. We'll hit add. We'll hit OK. And you know, the other thing that I'd like, I really don't want item there. I'd like to just get rid of that. So I'm just going to hit item. And I'm going to hit delete. Am I sure? Yes, I am. Cool. So now, back to our little movies here. Now, one little thing that I do want to mention is when we just go in and associate a content type, it's not going to automatically update our views here. So we would have to, if we wanted to, go into our view. Let's just go ahead and hit modify view.
And to add those additional columns?
Exactly, and yeah. Add that that description column. There we go. Scroll on down, movie description.
So all these other columns here, those weren't added by our content types. Those are base columns already on every list, right? So
exactly.
Things like modified by and modified date are standard fields that you get on every list.
Exactly. So now let me just scroll on down and hit OK. And now there's our little movie description. And oops, let's hit new item. And there's our little title, and I'll put in my favorite movie, High Fidelity, best John Cusack movie ever. And apparently, I'm just going to put eyes in the wrong spot. Movie ever. There we go. All right. And hit save. And sure enough, there's our little data. Cool.
So we could also have done this through Visual Studio, right? We could have also created our movie list and added the content type to that movie list direct from Visual Studio as well, right?
That's an excellent point. In fact, what do you say we talk about that? So let me go back to my slides here. There we go. Wait for this to come up. Movie mouse.
Ding.
Yes, yep. There we go. All right, I'm not gonna dance. All right. In any event, bring this back over here. So our custom list templates and definitions. So one of the things that Chris just mentioned is, you know, we could do this through Visual Studio. And the great advantage to doing this through Visual Studio is that now we'll be able to deploy this out along with the content type. Because typically, if you're creating a content type, you're eventually going to want a list. It's sort of the whole reason you're doing this. So we want to be able to create our template as well. And so you'll notice that we can do our template, we can do our definition, both through Visual Studio as well as through the UI. Now, if we do this through Visual Studio, and in particular, if we do this declaratively, there are going to be a couple little files and items that need to be created. We're going to need our feature file. We're going to need the manifest, which is going to describe the overall kind of just basics of, hey, this is our list, this is going to be the name, things like that. And we're going to have our schema. And our schema is going to be used to describe our data structure. So all the different views, all the different columns or fields. And by the way, let's highlight this real quick here. Going back to our conversation about site web, site collection, site, it's columns in the UI, it's fields when you're doing it declaratively or programmatically. Now, again, there's a designer.
It makes it so much easier to configure and add these things and pull that ugly XML together.
A designer. I'm so happy. Okay, so let's go back to my demo system here. Like, yeah, exactly. Yeah, keep doing that. I had to double check. I didn't turn off my monitor that time, I swear. Okay. Back over here, wait for Visual Studio. Perfect. All right, so now let's go ahead, right-click, add a new item. And there is our little list. And let's give this a name of movies. And before I do that, let me, real quick here, I'm going to avoid the mistake before it happens. Delete. Hit OK. There we go. All right. So now, back over here, let's go ahead and say movies. And let's hit add. And so now you're going to notice it'll say, all right, well, what name do you want? And we want movies. And what do we want to base it on? And we'll go ahead and base it on our custom list. And I'm going to hit finish in a second here. But I do want to highlight for my 2010 people that we had this in the past. That was there in 2010. But after you hit finish, all that it really did was just give you the ability to start editing XML.
Right. It got you started, but...
Yeah, and then just sort of left you there.
Right.
A designer.
So much easier. So now we're not just left with XML and a schema that you have to learn and you have to handcraft it all, right? But now we get a nice sort of UI over the top that we can fiddle around with and tweak without necessarily having to learn all that stuff.
Exactly.
Although, you can still get to all the underlying stuff.
Yes.
If you still want to jump into the XML and make, you know, tweaks on your own.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. So if you still truly want to do it, you can. In my case, I'm going to go ahead and click on content types there. And you'll notice right there, click to add. And if I scroll on down, there is our movie. Now, I want to highlight that, yes, we've already deployed movie. But this is pulling it from Visual Studio. So it's actually smart enough to realize, hey, look, there's a content type over here. We might want to use that content type. So it is making that available, even if I hadn't actually deployed it out yet.
Gotcha.
Okay. And on our item, let's go ahead and delete that. On our folder, let's go ahead and delete that. So all we have is just simply movie. That's all I want.
So by removing the folder, just so people are aware,
yeah.
It shows up in this designer, but when you go into a SharePoint list and you go up into the top left on the ribbon there, and you can create new folders and say a document library, if you don't want to have people be able to create new folders, then you can get rid of it here, and it will get rid of it off the list.
Yep, that's exactly it. Okay, so now let me hit OK, and voila, now I've got my title and I've got my movie description. Now, you'll notice that... And now I'm sort of wishing that I would have left the list up, but I'll go back and highlight it again in just a moment. What you're going to notice is that I'm creating a template here. And this is going to be used to create brand new movie lists, and this is going to be based off of that content type. At the end of the day, my list still needs to have columns associated with it. And so what you'll notice inside the UI right here is that it is still listing off my columns, because the columns need to be there. But where those columns are coming from is they're coming from my content type. So again, if I go back to my content type and I update that, that will then be reflected inside of here. Okay. So now you're going to notice that I've got views. So if I decide that I want to add in or tweak or modify my views, I can do that. So you'll notice that over here, there's all my different columns. It automatically grabbed my title, my movie description for me when I added in that content type. And if I decide, hey, there's a couple of other items that I want in there, maybe a created by, I could go ahead and bring over the created by as well and add that into my default all items view.
So the all items view is what you see when you first go to the list, right?
Yep.
And then you've added the created by column so that that's what shows up when you hit that view. Henrik in the chat asked about this and wanted to know how to configure views, so I hope that's answered his question.
Yep, and if you wanted a brand new view, just simply add new view. I'm just going to real quick just simply say Wibble. On my Wibble view, now I could go in and start creating everything inside of there.
Excellent.
Okay. And by the way, if you stick two pencils up your nose and just keep saying Wibble, it won't get you out of the army. Okay.
Or out of SharePoint development.
Or out of SharePoint development. Exactly. All right. In any event, there's probably four people that got that reference. And none of them are in this room. In any event, the last little thing that I want to mention is that this is going to create an instance of the list automatically for me. And I can choose if I want to not to have it create it. But I may as well go ahead and do it. So there's my movies. My movies stores a collection of movies. There we go. And now I've got all that created, set up, and ready to go. So, with that, let's go ahead, right-click, deploy. And with blinding speed and amazing accuracy, it will then deploy that out. And let me go back home. There we go. And so now you're going to notice recent, because we just created it. There's my little movies. And I'm going to click movies. And you'll notice that there's my title. There's my movie description, and there's my created by. That was the view that we just created. You're also going to notice that if I go into new item, or better yet, if I hit the drop down on new item, what you're going to notice is that there is my little movie content type. You'll notice that it says describe moves, because again, I still don't have an I in there, but that's all right. But what you're going to notice is that there is that content type. So if I hit new item, if I hit new item, if I hit new item and then movie, that in all three of those cases, I'm now going to get this little screen right here. I can then go ahead and give this a title, Black Adder, and then my description, not really a movie, but that's where Wibble is from. There you go. It's a BBC show.
Baldrick.
Yes. Hmm. Ah, you did get the reference. Excellent. Okay. So we'll go ahead and hit save, and sure enough, there is my new little item. Now, before I leave this behind, I do want to go back into my list settings here, if for no other reason than just to highlight the columns down below. And so what you'll notice is we've got the things like created and modified, created by, modified by, and that's just SharePoint stuff. But the part that we added in was that right there, which is our movie description and our title. And you'll notice the used in, and that's telling us where those came from. So in this case, it came from our movie content type.
Yep. So you've got your description, you've got your title that's come through from that's inherited from item, and then you've added it to this list, and those get pushed down as columns.
Yep. There it is.
Got it.
Cool. All right. We'll go back to our slides here. Minimize. Bring that back up.
Somebody actually pointed out, could you tell us the specs of the dev machine that you're using in this demo? Because they're surprised at how fast something's ready after you deploy. Do you know off the top of your head?
So I would say a couple of real quick things to that. That number one, it's now I'm trying to remember. I think it's configured with 16 gigs and 6 cores. So I mean, it's set to really kind of move along. The other thing that I would mention is we're doing sandbox solutions here. Mm. We're not doing farm solutions. So for those of you who've done things in 2010 and are much more familiar with doing farm solutions, the biggest thing about doing a farm solution is you need that IIS reset to get everything back to life again. Because of the fact that we're doing sandbox solutions, we don't need that. And that, I think, is a bigger reason as opposed to just the specs as to why it's there basically instantaneously.
It is a huge benefit, right?
Yeah.
Not having to cycle that whole process back up, you're just dropping it in the sandbox, spinning that up, and away you go.
Exactly. Yep. Yeah. So I think it's sort of the combination of two things there. Okay. Last but not least is setting up our own custom sites here. Now, we can set up custom sites in a couple of different ways. One way that we can do this is by utilizing a site definition. The great advantage to a site definition is the fact that this is not going to be dependent on any other component. That everything that I put inside of there is going to be specific for that definition. It can exist all on its own, and it doesn't need anything else configured on there, that it can just bring everything along that it needs for the ride. There are a couple of problems with this, the biggest of which you're going to notice has to be deployed out with a farm solution, which goes against everything that we've been saying and talking about up until this point here.
Yeah, you can't send it off into SharePoint Online, for example.
Right.
It gets deployed as a file. You have to be an admin to put it out on the box there. All the files go down onto the file system on SharePoint, and then it's replicated across the different web front ends and so forth.
Exactly. Now, the easier way to do things is to create a web template. Now, you are going to notice that you could do this programmatically, just simply save as template. You'll also notice that you could do this in the UI as well, which is what I'm going to demo here in just a couple of minutes. There is one very big catch, however. The one problem that we do have with doing web templates is that we're not actually creating a true definition. What we're really doing is setting up a Delta file. It's going to be built on top of the existing definition. So when you go to deploy this out to the remote system, if you do not have that original definition, this is not going to work.
This is a really important point, I think.
Yeah.
Especially if you're wanting to move solutions between different environments, right?
Yep.
Then if you're doing a site definition and you deploy it, all those files go down onto the box. And then if you create sites based on that definition, they're reliant on those files being on the SharePoint server. So if you back that site up and move it,
yep.
You also have to make sure that those site definitions have been deployed to that farm first so that your site knows where to find the files and everything works nice and smooth. Whereas site templates go as part of the content.
Exactly, exactly.
But are still reliant on the definition that they inherit from.
Right.
Yep.
Yep. Now, there are two little files that are going to be used to create a site definition. We've got our web temp, we've got our onit file that are going to have all the different configuration definitions and the site structure, and then again, we can include all of our different pages and so forth. But here's the couple of very big downsides to, again, doing our site definitions. Number one is I want to highlight down here at the very bottom our deployment location. You are going to notice that these need to go out to the SharePoint root, out to the local file system. So again, they will only work with a farm solution. The other very big thing is this, and I'm going to throw my demo slide here and then kick over to my demo box. And waiting. Okay, and let's bring that up and let's just bring back up Visual Studio here. All right, so what I'm going to do is say add new item, and from inside of here, you're going to notice there's my site definition, and it tells me right away farm solution only. And I'm going to hit add. Where's our wizard? Where's our designer? Unfortunately, we don't have a designer or a wizard here yet. So you will have to go in and modify the XML directly. Now, if we are just going to do this through the browser, which is definitely an easier way to do it, and in my experience, and I'm pretty sure your experience as well, this is the way that honestly most people do it.
Definitely.
So all I have to do is just go back to my little gear and site settings, and then right in the middle,
really gone. Save as site template. Have you got publishing features turned on by any chance?
I very well may.
So publishing features,
yeah,
if I'm not mistaken,
they
will turn off the save site as template.
Yep. And no, my publishing is off.
Maybe off in the site collection. Oh, no. Interesting. What are we missing? Should be over under the site actions menu over on the right-hand side there. Not sure what template
this
or
is
definition
just,
you created
you know why?
Site
this
from.
Is the developer template.
Gotcha.
So,
gotcha.
Yeah, so it's not in there. You know, let me...
create a team site or
you know
something
what? Yeah,
those
here,
lines?
let's actually just do this. Here's what I'm going to do. Is it would actually be right there. The link would be right there, and it would just simply say, hey, what name do you want to give it? This is actually not on the developer site. And the reason that I have the developer site here, and this is a very important point going forward, is when we get into doing apps... One of the big restrictions to deploying out an app is that typically this needs to go into the app catalog, which makes things a bit of a pain if I'm trying to do testing, deployment, debugging, and all that good stuff. Because what I always have to then do is I always have to then add that into the app catalog and then go to the site and add it in, and away we go. What we really want to be able to do is just simply push it right into the site, or what's right. known as side loading. And in order to do that, the developer feature must be turned on, or you have to be using the developer template. And so that's why it's not there. It's because I've got this on the developer template.
Yeah, so the other reason that you might be missing this under the site actions there is if folk, I get people ask this quite often, is where's that site template link gone? And if you've got the publishing features turned on in a site,
yep.
then that, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that link also
same.
Disappears.
Yeah, it is yep. the exact same. Cool. All right. So with that, whoops. I apologize. I forgot to give my guys in the back there a warning of, hey, by the way, I'm going to go to the slides. Surprise!
It's not quite as magical as it looks, huh?
Yeah, exactly. In any event, let's go ahead and do this. So what we saw in that module was how to go in and create our site columns, how to go in and create our content types, how to go in and create our list templates, which is... seriously, in my opinion, probably the second coolest new development feature that we have in SharePoint. I love the workflows, but that really is, I think, the coolest thing. And then also, we talked about the ability to go in and create our site templates and our site definitions. And doing all of that is going to give you that reuse and that consistency of your data and that consistent structure throughout your entire environment. So, with that, what do you say we take a break for a meal? It's lunch where we happen to be. It's whatever meal it is that it happens to be wherever you're at.
Breakfast or dinner, maybe?
Yes,
or, I'm not sure.
Yeah, the second breakfast.
Right.
Yeah. Who knows? Late night snack. But in any event, let's go ahead and take 45, and then we'll come on back and pick it up with the next module. We'll start getting in and doing some client-side development, which will roll us naturally into apps. So we'll see you guys.
I think it's going to be a lot more code-heavy from this point on, right? This is a lot of introductory stuff so far.
Yeah.
So go and have something to eat and get ready for some deep dive into Visual Studio.
Yep. We'll see you guys in 45.